Tell us about what supports that view.
I think we have seen in last year a growth of around 600%. We see a huge mass market adoption of traditional finance players coming into the market, as well as retail driving the market. Natural developments like the pro shares Bitcoin ETF helps that in the mass market adoption. But we see this also from the rising inflation, that there's more and more interest in that because this is an asset outside of the classical financial system, and actually pretty interesting interest rates to be gained on that one on an annualized basis, over 10% sometimes. So I think that all adds up to being a pretty much good rally, and it's not the end yet.
Alex, well, first, nice to see you. I think last time we spoke was 7 months ago, and I think back then you were talking about how you guys were going to roll out more products for the institutional investor. I was wondering if you can give us an update of the business.
Yes. So we're rolling out spot brokerage, custody information products, and educational arm, the academy around that. Most of these offerings will be getting live starting next year. I think it's an ideal moment because we see a lot of consolidation coming probably next year and further traditional players coming into that market. It is a race. I think we'll see a lot of developments happening next year, especially also around regulation. More and more countries are forming regulation around the digital asset space. And from our point of view, we are then very much well suited and situated to exploit and further grow in this direction. The market is growing tremendously, so we'll see a lot of growth beyond, let's say, competitive growth still. So I think we're very well suited and positioned to exploit that.
And on some of your leverage products, there has been some regulation to rein part of that in. I don't remember exactly how much leverage I could get on one of your products. If you could remind us what you offer, and what do you think of regulation as far as that is concerned?
The globally most traded product, and also with BitMEX, is the perpetual swap, the future that trades like a spot product, and you can trade it to up to 100 leverage. I think we'll see that the cryptocurrency development, or the cryptocurrency ecosystem, will be regulated pretty much in the same direction as we've seen it from the classical world, and that means also for the future side of that one. Now, what we have to make sure is that we educate the regulatory authorities to not hinder the possible and positive environment of blockchain and cryptocurrencies, and so that we get it to a sensible regulation when it comes to regulating derivatives products. With there's not a lot of regulators already out there regulating these, and it's up to us to help them to understand it, because they have different marketers, from our point of view, much less market risks than classical futures and futures products.
Alex, how does this crackdown in China affect your business? That's one part of my question. And the other part is, does it in some way make you look as though, hey, I think I probably need to get out of Hong Kong?
Now, I think we have to zoom out a little bit and look from a broader standpoint. There's two aspects to that. The first aspect is we see a lot of countries very openly adopting rules and regulations on cryptocurrencies. And on the other side, there's a tremendous necessity to have CBDCs up there for the next evolving step of the digital global ecosystem. And China is very innovative when it comes to that. They very early on said that they will be working on CBDCs, and something that also ECB and other countries are working on. So there's a very positive development going on.
You're talking about the digital RMB, yes.
Yes, for example. And we have to see here for Hong Kong and Asia how the regulatory regimes will develop. It's much too early for that to already say whether this is a good place or this is a good place. But generally, we see it positively that they are working on that.
Yep. Okay, so that is almost a competition. They're trying to steal crypto's thunder in a way, are they not?
I wouldn't say this. I think that there's much more to that. When you look at how we think the crypto ecosystem is evolving, in comparison to the classical financial industry, it's still very, very small. And we need to have that mass market adoption in. As I said before, we need central bank digital currencies for the next evolving step of use cases for the global financial economy. And for that, that's very important. And whatever regulatory regimes are doing to suit that and actually support it, it's a good movement. I think this is also coming with more and more countries that we predict are adopting Bitcoin as a legal tender in the, let's say, in the field of inflation, remittance, and dependency on global fiat currencies. I think we'll see much more there too. And that also then fuels again the CBDC move.
Alex, I've been to your office. It's a very nice office. It's second only to Bloomberg. I'm kidding. But the reason I ask you that, Rish just asked you, I think, what do you think about regulation and China cracking down on crypto specifically. I'm wondering how big of a risk do you consider that regulation coming to Hong Kong? One country, two systems, but it's not completely out of, out of imagination, if you will.
I think what we need to do as an industry, we need to get really in close contact with the regulators and explain them the positive possibilities of blockchain and digital assets, as well as work together with them on a sensible regulatory regime. We cannot just lay back and expect them to come up with that on their own. We need to educate them, we need to help them understand, and we need to work together with them on that one. And I'm sure that, at least in the past, in my past, that I worked with regulators directly, right, that was seen very positively. But it's our obligation, we have to do it as an industry, and I think as an industry we could do much more there. And in that sense, we will be working with the government here as good as we can and reach out to them, and hopefully we can come up with a sensible regulatory framework here, but as well as in other regulatory environments.
Alex, when we look at this new process ETF, okay, you mentioned that earlier, that's again lending more credence to this space, I suppose, right?
Yes.
But you've got an ETF which is a futures contract. It has to be rolled over every month.
Yes.
That costs a lot of money. We're talking about fees of up to 10% or thereabouts annually.
Yes.
On top of management fees.
Yes.
Okay. Then you've got no holding of the underlying asset.
Yes.
You can't take collection of this Bitcoin at the end of the contract like you can do. It's actually like a scam ultimately. I mean, really, you can call it anything then, you know, make an ETF out of anything as far as I'm concerned. So it's not an ETF and it's a non-deliverable forward, isn't it?
I wouldn't go as far as you pointed out, but the point is naturally that the ETF shows two things. There's a tremendous interest from a lot of classical investors into Bitcoin underlyings, but it's still, from the industry standpoint, much too complicated to actually get in direct access of the underlying. So the process ETF...
Why not just buy the Bitcoin itself?
Yeah, but it's still, for a lot of, especially when it comes to institutional players, there's a legal framework which is still missing. It is a very easy way to get into that. The biggest issue from my point of view is 24/7 trading of the underlying, but not 24/7 trading of the actual ETF. How does that work out if you have tremendous price movements on the underlying? So that's what we have to find out. So in that sense, yes, it is.
But there is no underlying asset.
There is an underlying asset with a Bitcoin.
But you can't take delivery.
Well, yes, but there is like every ETF that you can structure. The Bitcoin is an underlying that you have there.
But you can't take delivery.
Yes.
I think David wants the last one.
Yeah.
Okay, well, I can't let you go without asking you then about your projection on Bitcoin itself. Okay, let's say you do go the direct Bitcoin route, and the legal framework of your institution allows you to do so. You have a forecast. What is that forecast based on?
The forecast mainly is based on the wide interest, as I said before, the wide interest of mass retail, of institutional players, more and more coming into that one, on countries accepting Bitcoin as legal tenders, high inflation rates, the possibility to earn real interest on Bitcoin holdings instead of in stark contrast to fiat currencies. As I said, annualized can be even above 10%, something that you not so easily, especially on the retail side, can generate somewhere else. And you have an asset class totally outside of the classical financial system. So that makes you resilient about potential negative developments on the global financial markets. So this in combination, I think we can likely see 100,000 at the end of the year.